Welcome back to The Heat. We're discussing the deteriorating security situation in Libya 3 years after the fall of Muammar Gaddafi. Joining us from Nairobi is Richard Bailey. He's a communications advisor who worked for the Libyan government. Here in our Washington, D.C. studio is Phyllis Bennis. She's written extensively about the Middle East and is a fellow with the Institute for Policy Studies. We're also joined by Hafed Al-Ghwell, a Middle East and North Africa analyst. Richard, let me start with you again. You've previously worked for the Libyan government. We had the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon pay a surprise visit to Libya earlier this month. He says there has to be a ceasefire. That ceasefire has to be observed. Do you believe there is a chance for diplomacy here? What is the message the government should be sending to the international community?
Well, I think genuinely there still remains some hope within Libya. I know things are looking very, very bad at the moment, but there is a political roadmap in place, and that needs the resolute determination to see it through. The UN, the international community are doing some good work in Libya to try and support it. The trouble is every time you think things have got as bad as they can get, they promptly get a bit worse. So of course the question becomes how or when or what do we do to help? I think we should look therefore at an example where the international community has played a role and has brought to bear a solution that is working. In Somalia, the African Union and Amazon provided a security infrastructure, a security scaffolding, if you like, that subdued al-Shabaab, subdued terrorist activity, and allowed the international community to rebuild and start to help rebuild the political and institutional and governance structure within Somalia, led by UN SRSG Ambassador Mahiga and the then Prime Minister Abdel-Fattah. They drove through a political roadmap with utter resolute determination within a security platform provided by the African Union. And I think in a world where we are looking for solutions to this sort of problem, we have to look at example which over the past 5 years has shown some real progress. I believe that in Libya, the ingredients to success are local leadership, technocratic leadership, a bit of muscle to ensure that you can uphold security. Some economic activity is essential to this. And as I say, resolute determination to drive through a political roadmap.
Hafed, you have written, you've said, that political dialogue must be the solution in Libya. Let's look at one of the initiatives that have taken place recently, and that is Egypt and Sudan have agreed now that they will be on the side of the government supporting this fight against Islamic extremism. I mean, do you support such an initiative?
I support all initiatives. There is the Algeria initiative, which is to host reconciliation talks. There is the Bernardino inside Libya among certain parts. There is the Egyptian. There is no other solution to this, because you're not dealing with just two parties here or any party that is able militarily to enforce its will. There's no way to win this militarily. So everybody has to be able to sit down. Libyans will never agree on the past, but they can agree on the future. And that should include the over 1 million Libyan exiles in Egypt and Tunisia who were allied with Gaddafi, who are now outside of the country. You cannot build a country if 20% of its population or 25% of its population is exiled of fear. So everybody needs to sit down and talk. The real missing ingredients here is what Richard referred to as the muscle. Is that the international community still does not, or anybody, I mean, the Libyan government, nobody has the stick. Everybody is offering carrots, but nobody has a stick to make sure that the militia sides, because the problem is you have certain political forces in play, you can talk to these people reasonably, but then you have the militias who hold the guns. These guys are motivated by criminal interest. These are really criminal gangs in the sense that they have figured out a way to make a living and make a very good living using their guns, smuggling arms, smuggling illegal migrants to Europe, drugs, all kinds of things. These guys are not politicians. They're not interested in political settlements. They're interested in chaos that allows them to run these kind of criminal activities across all borders.
Right, Phyllis?
I think that it is right that there needs to be discussions between all sides. And I think this notion that there is no military solution is absolutely right here, as much as it is in Syria, in Iraq. Everywhere else, we're hearing those words from President Obama, but we're not seeing that action. Where I think we have to be very cautious is on the notion that somehow putting in a bigger stick or more sticks is going to make things better. What we've seen in Libya is that the presence of vast troves of weapons has made everything worse. From the beginning of the nonviolent uprising against Gaddafi through the process of the war, the presence of weapons, and now in the aftermath, has made and continues to make everything worse. And the other problem that we face, even the diplomacy, while I agree that everybody has to be at the table, and the fact that Sudan and Egypt are now involved, that's all fine, but we also have to be clear that the politics there comes into play very directly. The Egyptian president, who came to power in a military coup against the Muslim Brotherhood, has made clear that his view of politics in the region is that anything that will subdue who he identifies as Islamist forces is fine,
and
whatever the aftermath.
That's the danger of Haftar, because he's allied to the
same. All of them.
But on the stick, you cannot do it when you have 10,000 militias, gangsters, each one of them is running around.
That's right. And the problem of multiple militias is a huge problem
But Phyllis, let me ask you
this. But there is a military. These government, competing government forces also have competing armies. Now, they are nothing more than bigger militias.
Yes,
they are bigger militias.
Exactly.
This is exactly the case in Iraq. The answer is not more weapons. The answer is to create political realities
but
on the ground.
But nobody's saying weapons, Phyllis. A stick does not mean weapons. It means international sanctions, which the UN has alluded to.
The sanctions are not going to affect the militias. They operate outside of those realities.
They can, because they need their money that they are earning in hard currency is being transferred in banks in Europe.
Okay, Phyllis, is this conflict being seen by the United States as not just a conflict that's confined to Libya, but as part of the wider battle against Islamic extremism?
And it's wrong, I think, because it's, again, it's the problem of President Sisi in Egypt, who sees everyone who has any kind of an Islamic flavor as ISIS, that must be killed, must be destroyed. It's this Manichaean view of black or white, you're either with us or you're against us, you're either going to accept our version or we're going to treat you like you're a terrorist. And it doesn't take into account that in this era, the overwhelming majority of public mobilization, public opposition to international intervention, et cetera, is taking an Islamic form.
I just want to get Richard in for a moment. I'll come to you, Hafed. Richard, how important is Libya's strategic location, if I could put it that way? It's 600 kilometers from Europe. It's seen as a gateway to Africa. How important is Libya?
Well, I think that Libya's exceptionally important, and most especially to Europe, on two levels. Firstly, the anarchy in Libya, as Hafed has already alluded to, is providing a pathway in and out of Africa for people, guns, ammunition, drugs, and anything really that you can or would like to buy your way through the anarchy. We are seeing boatload after boatload of illegal immigrants leaving Libyan shores and drowning in the Mediterranean on their way to Europe. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. But of course, Libya also provides the linchpin in the ever-widening global onslaught of al-Qaeda franchises across Middle East and North Africa. In the post 9/11 era, a breakdown in security provides the ideal breeding ground for extremist groups, whether it's Ansar Sharia or Al-Shabaab or Boko Haram or ISIS. They all emerge out of anarchy and out of insecurity. And I would just like to suggest that if we don't secure Libya against this, the disciples of Osama bin Laden, if you would like to call them that, will have freedom to move from Mombasa in the south to Mosul in the north, and from Lahore in the east to Bamako in the west. And as we've seen from the pictures coming out of Iraq, the consequences of losing Libya don't bear thinking about.
Okay, Hafed, you wanted to say?
A couple of points. I entirely agree with Richard. I mean, Libya is of a strategic importance to North Africa, to the Sahel, which is Mali, Chad, Niger, and to Europe, the Mediterranean security. So it may not be of direct importance strategically, as Secretary Gates said, to the United States, but if it collapses, it will become a serious problem. Second point is what Phyllis said about the Islamists. This is the danger that we are entering in the entire Middle East. If you make it hard for even the moderate Islamic forces to find a space for themselves within the democratic or the transition process, and you label all of them with the same brush, there is no incentive for any of these people with any sort of religious calling to actually play the game of politics. They will all resort. And we know that it was the harshness of the Egyptian governments in the past against the Muslim Brotherhood that splintered them into these extremist groups, including Al-Qaeda. Okay. Because the younger generation of these Islamists will say to the older, wiser guys, well, you know,
we tried it your way,
okay, and we get nowhere but jails and being tortured and so on. So
okay, Phyllis, I got 5 seconds. Quick answer: is Libya better off today than it was 3 years ago?
No.
Libya is a mess today, and for the vast majority of Libyans under Gaddafi, there was repression for those who opposed, but otherwise, it was a stable, wealthy country, the wealthiest in all of Africa.
Okay, that's where we have to leave it. Thanks to all of you for joining
us. Thank you.